Hello and welcome to this edition of Peak Life. Today, we've got a lot to talk about, so I've got the man here with me, Earl Sorey, Assistant Director of Public Works. Thank you so much for being here today.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Big topic to discuss. We've got some work planned for the Centerville Turnpike Bridge. Tell us what's going on.
Yes, so it's going to be a busy summer and fall for us this year. So, you know, the bridge has gotten to the point where there's some major rehab work that needs to be done to extend the life of the bridge. And by major, I mean we're going to have to take the bridge out of commission for a while we do some reconstruction. And one of the main things is, as you know, that's a movable bridge, and it swings. And what it swings on is referred to as a pivot pier. Okay. Well, that's one of the main things that has to be reconstructed. And the only way you can reconstruct it is to take the bridge off of it and start rebuilding. So that's a big part of that process. There's a number of things that we'll be doing also, redecking the bridge, repainting it. We've got to mitigate and get the lead paint off of the bridge. So lot of things, but the painful part for our viewers and our motorists is going to be an approximate 6 month closure of the roadway while we work on the bridge.
And we expect that to start end of July?
End of July, okay. and go through the remainder of the year.
Okay. Whenever we hear about a bridge having major rehabilitation needs, the safety concern always comes up. Is the bridge safe for now?
Yes, the bridge is safe. It's structurally sound. A lot of the issues that we're dealing with now are the mechanical issues, and we've seen that upriver recently with the North Landing Bridge. So, you know, that's an old bridge as well. And, you know, and it's showing its age, and the mechanical components are to the point where replacement parts aren't on a shelf somewhere. So when it breaks, they have to be fabricated, and that takes time. And unfortunately, recently we've been going through a number of unplanned closures that are very disruptive. So as much as we hate to close the road, it's the necessary thing to do so that we can do it with the plan in place, and we can do it with a contractor ready to go and ready to make a very necessary improvement.
So we're doing this now for an extended period of time so that we don't have to do it without warning every other weekend here into the future when it just breaks or stops working.
That's right. Yeah, okay. just like an old car that starts to break down. That's where we are. And so this project was scoped a year ago. The Virginia Department of Transportation has provided funding towards this. So, you know, we certainly don't take this lightly, but it is definitely necessary work.
Now, why not just replace it? We've done some large-scale bridge replacements here in Chesapeake in recent history. Why not just go ahead and replace the whole thing?
So that will come in time.
Okay.
So, you know, that is probably, if I had to put a price tag on that, that's tops over $100 million for a replacement bridge.
Wow.
But we are studying that now because, as you know, it takes a long time to come up with a funding and financing plan for a project of that magnitude. So City Council provided funding for a feasibility study to look at alternate alignments, to look at fixed span bridges similar to what we have on the Great Bridge Bypass. So that work is underway now. We expect that to be wrapped up next year, but that will allow us a platform to start putting that funding plan together and start seeking, you know, outside funds that we can leverage with city funds.
So this is a more immediate fix for motorists to get it done.
The plan here is to give us another 15 to 20 years with the existing bridge while we put a plan in place for a more permanent replacement.
Right, and it'll still be the same amount of lanes, all that sort of stuff will remain the same?
It'll still be the same. It's gonna look different because we're gonna paint it to match our other drawbridges while we have the opportunity.
Oh, very nice.
It'll carry the green color that we have it at the Great Bridge Bridge and at Gilmerton. So, you know, we think that will be a nice touch, but it's gonna be much more dependable. Yeah, that's really what we're looking at. And there's a number of mitigation steps that we're taking. We know, and we're not gonna sugarcoat it, this is gonna be some of the worst sustained traffic congestion the city of Chesapeake's ever seen.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And unfortunately, there's just no way around that. There's 16,000 vehicles a day that cross the Centerville Turnpike Bridge. Those trips are gonna be diverted elsewhere. You know, the majority of that traffic is going to end up on the Chesapeake Expressway, on local Battlefield Boulevard, on Mount Pleasant Road. So, you know, we've had a traffic analysis of those alternate routes. We know where the hot spots are going to be. We're going to be modifying traffic signal timings. We're going to be monitoring traffic and making adjustments. But since this closure of a bridge that carries that kind of traffic is unprecedented, we're doing some unprecedented things as well. So, for instance, we are suspending all daytime work activities on the alternate routes.
Okay.
So simple things like patching potholes is going to be done at night.
Right.
That's going to apply equally to city forces as it does to the developers. So as they're doing their work, you know, that they're going to share some of this pain as well, but it's necessary so that we can keep traffic moving as much as possible during this closure.
Because those small little single lane closure for just a couple hours, depending on time of day and load of traffic, can really make a big difference. So
yes, they can be very disruptive.
Yeah. Of course, summer is a huge traffic time for this route.
It is. And so, you know, there's pros and cons, right? So, you know, once school starts back, there's going to be school impacts. Now, we know there's not a lot of school traffic that actually crosses the bridge, but they're going to be sitting in traffic like everybody else on the alternate route. So there's going to be delays there. We're very sensitive to some of the businesses that are very dependent on time. So we've reached out to the 60 plus daycares in the city. To provide information with them just to know what to expect, you know. And that's a big part of our strategy, too, is just getting the word out, letting people know what to expect.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's some businesses that can allow people to telework or that can flex hours, and we certainly want to encourage them to do that. And, you know, when we're looking at displacing 16,000 vehicles a day, we understand that maybe not all of them are going to make those trips. There's going to be some discretionary trips to where, you know, they may not cross the water to go to that same shop. They may change their behaviors for that period of time. And so we're trying to accommodate roughly 75% of the traffic that we have today.
Okay.
And so that's what our timing plans are set on. Time will tell. So we will be, you know, monitoring that very closely.
Okay. Now you mentioned businesses. What about those businesses right along Centerville? Will we still have access to them? The marina, there's a, I believe, landscaping business over there. How will we maintain access to those Centerville Turnpike businesses?
Yes. So access to all the businesses will still be available, obviously, from the respective sides of the canal. We're installing signs for the businesses to make sure motorists know that they can get there.
Great.
You know, we'll be working with them closely. And much like we did with Dominion Boulevard, we'll be reaching out to the business community, keeping them informed, having a series of project updates. And we have a wonderful project website that we're working on, you know, a lot of very good information. You know, we'll be working with you and your counterparts to try to get information out through the various social media sites. And I think that's going to be critical to provide that real-time information as we get into this.
So let's talk about how to get that info. I'm going to check my notes to make sure that I get this right. You guys are putting out tons of detail, which is really great. And I understand that that's going to be vibrant throughout this project. Y'all are going to continue to keep an eye on that. And if something changes, that'll be posted. So we really want people to stay tuned in.
Yes.
A couple different things, and we'll put this up on your screen. You can actually get text alerts specific to this project.
That's right.
By texting Peake Traffic to 888-777. And of course, that website that you mentioned is cityofchesapeake.net/Centerville. And as always, for traffic alerts, road advisories, you can follow twitter.com/Chesapeake Roads. So lots of options to stay informed.
Yes.
I love it. Earl, anything else you want to say about this upcoming closure?
You know, we just ask for the public's patience as we work through this. And, you know, this is one of those situations where there's going to be some growing pains as we're going through it, but it's ultimately going to lead to a much more dependable route for us. And we are going to continue with the feasibility study to figure out a long-term solution that's going to support, you know, mobility and economic development in the city for years to come.
Great. More info to come. Earl Sorey, Assistant Director of Public Works. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Really appreciate it. So don't forget, cityofchesapeake.net/Centerville for all of your information. Thank you so much for joining us. We'll be sure to keep you updated on another edition of Peake Life.